Okay, I'll call the Board of Selectmen's meeting for Monday, October 5th to order. Would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Have anybody for weekly briefing? Paula? How are you?
I am well, how are you?
Great.
Good. I hope we all stay that way. That's a good cue for flu season. We do have a change in the Health Department this year. We've been studying the attendance at our flu clinics for the past several years, and with the plethora of choices and with insurance being accepted at so many different locations, we've seen the numbers dwindle at our clinics. And this year, for the first time, the Mass Department of Public Health is no longer providing free vaccine to local health departments. So after much study and with heavy heart to leave a cornerstone program of our health department, we have decided to no longer host a public flu clinic. While it is sad, the upside is that we are saying that our public health mission has been accomplished. It's not very often that we are able to put a program to rest because it is now widely accepted and available in the community. We've seen our numbers go from upwards of 1,800 people coming to that clinic a dozen years ago to then Medicare covering the shots went in half. Now with all of the insurance companies, we served barely 200 people from the general public last year. So we feel that our resources are better spent in other places. And so we just want to make sure that the public is aware. We continue to get calls. We've had some publicity, but we need to do it, get the word out there. We will not be holding a clinic this year, but we have at least six places in Harwich that are accepting clients on a walking basis. The Fontaine Medical Center, Stop and Shop, Star Market, two CVS's, and the Rite Aid. Those are all places that are willing, ready, and able to provide you with vaccine and a shot. So we encourage everyone to continue participate. Please get your flu shot, but it will be through one of the private markets.
Yeah, I think, Paul, if I just say, I think as you just said, it's important to get your flu shot, even though we're not going to sponsor or have it this year. But you guys are really the trendsetters or the forerunners or whatever you want to call it. Back when you had 1,800 customers, you're the only game in town basically at one point. And everybody else, I think, then realized how important it was and started to catch on and started working that way.
So yes, we're very pleased to say mission accomplished.
Yeah, nice.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, then we'll move on to public comment or announcements. Anybody have anything? I'll just say go ahead.
Whoa.
You just made the lights go out.
Vicki Goldsmith from Habitat for Humanity of Cape Cod. I want to thank you, Peter, for coming to the dedication of the Blitz build. I think it meant a lot to the home builders who contributed so much. And I also would like to acknowledge that we could not possibly have done it without amazing cooperation from the town's inspection departments, not approving anything they shouldn't, but coordinating with a Blitz build meant a lot of flexibility on their part in scheduling. So we really appreciate that. Thank you.
And could you just tell us how many contractors you had working, refresh our memories over the course of the week?
There were about 75 companies participating, either as suppliers or contractors, and then there were the individuals associated, and then, of course, some people just came as individual professionals. So I'd say there were probably about 200 participants in about 75 companies. Yeah. So
great event. Thank you.
Thank you.
You'd be congratulated. On public comments announcement, I'll just tell everybody I did see Lou Urbano on Saturday. He looked much better than I had seen him look in the last several weeks since he had his accident. He was back, I believe today he texted me and said he was back up at the hospital getting checked. But they're fighting this infection he's had, and they think they have the right combination of medication now. So he's doing better. He's to the point, if someone's interested, wants to stop by and see him, I think he'd look forward to that. So even if it's only for 5 minutes, and I think Sally would enjoy the break, quite frankly. But so we wish him well. All right, anybody else? I will move on to the consent agenda. Janelle?
Mr. Chair, I move that we, A, approve minutes from 1 September 8th, 2015 executive session, 2 September 14th, 2015 regular session, 3 September 21st, 2015 executive session, and 4 September 21st, 2015 regular session. B, approve the application for hawkers and peddlers license by Pilgrim Lodge. C, approve the application for lodging house license for Gingerbread House. D, accept the resignation of Eileen Brady from the Historic District Historical Commission effective September 24th, 2015. E, accept various gift donations to be deposited into the Saucotucket Harbor Demolition Beautification Account. And F, confirm the appointment of Alexandra Olson to the position of part-time community center clerical aide, PT3 Step 5, at the rate of $14.85 per hour.
Second.
Moved and seconded to accept the consent agenda. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll put it to a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. It's a vote. Move on to public hearings, and we'll do our annual meetings. The Planning Board. Jim, you're up.
Okay.
Jim Atkinson, how are you, sir?
I'm fine. Good evening. As Peter had mentioned, my name is Jim Atkinson, and I am chairman of the Planning Board. I am here tonight to give you a brief overview of the activities of the Planning Board over the past year. During this period, 24 applications were submitted to the Planning Board, including 9 approval not required plans, 2 subdivision plans for the creation of a total of 12 new lots or 12 dwelling units, 11 special permits, including site plan permits, and 2 covenant releases. Major items in front of the Planning Board over the past year also included the rezoning of the East Harwich Commercial District, Route 28 planning, including Saucotucket Harbor, bylaw revisions for village development in Harwichport and Harwich Center, and an application by Cumberland Farms for expansion of their facility in Harwichport. The Planning Board East Harwich Subcommittee continued meetings in 2015 to refine the proposed zoning for the East Harwich Commercial District. After hearing a report from the Cape Cod Commission staff in December of 2014 regarding traffic issues in this area, the direction, the subcommittee scaled back the proposed zoning density for East Harwich. Based on direction from the subcommittee, the town planner, David Spitz, prepared a new draft of the East Harwich zoning patterned after the 2011 East Harwich Village Handbook. The new draft included the same district boundaries and site coverage as the 2011 handbook. However, it did not include the natural resource zoning proposed at that time and instead recommended alternate methods of providing open space preservation. The draft has been completed and has been endorsed by the East Harwich Subcommittee. It will now be presented to the full Planning Board and, if supported by the Planning Board, then presented to the Board of Selectmen. The Planning Board initiated a planning effort for the entire Route 28 commercial corridor in 2015. After reviewing results from Route 28 planning workshops held 10 years ago, updated concepts were developed in Planning Board work sessions, and these concepts will be presented to the full Planning Board for discussion in the very near future, probably sometime this month. The area around Saucotucket Harbor will be included in the full Route 28 planning effort. However, a Planning Board Saucotucket Harbor Subcommittee formed in 2014 was inactive during 2015 to avoid interference with the new Saucotucket Harbor Development Committee appointed by this Board of Selectmen. A Planning Board member does serve on that committee. After more than a year of public hearings, the Planning Board denied Cumberland Farms' application based on a finding that the proposed layout did not meet the standards for the Village Commercial Overlay District. That district requires new development in Harwichport's Village Center to be in keeping with its historic development patterns, including the size and spacing of structures. The applicant has appealed the Planning Board's decision, and the case is now in litigation. In the coming year, the Planning Board is expected to both continue its regulatory approval process and proceed with Route 28 planning. Time permitting, the Planning Board will also begin an update of the local comprehensive plan, which was last approved in 2011. It is my feeling that we currently have a strong and competent board that reflects the existing community and hope to have a very productive year. Please let me know if you have any questions or comments. Thank you.
Okay, Jim, are you at full staffing? I shouldn't say full membership.
Yes, we are, okay, well, with two alternates.
Okay, and everybody on your committee has been sworn in and has gone through the ethics training, et cetera, et cetera?
As far as I know, but I'll double check.
Okay, it's always something we're looking for.
Right.
Could I just ask on the East Harwich?
Sure.
When would you speculate it would come to us?
We expect that the Planning Board will make a determination as to whether it can endorse this proposal by the end of October. And then, assuming that the Planning Board endorses the current proposal, we would then like to submit it to the Board of Selectmen for review and comments before we proceed any further. So I would be expecting that maybe sometime around November we would be doing that.
Okay, before Thanksgiving, maybe.
Yes, correct.
Like that. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, and we'll give you the draft of it and introduce it to you and then give you time to review it. And then at a later meeting we'll be present to answer any questions or respond to any comments you may have.
Okay. Yeah, the other one is, the question I have is on the Cumberland Farms application.
Yes.
I know it's in litigation. I do think, we'll see what the board wants to do, but it would be helpful to me if we could have you or someone come in, just explain to us what it's all about, so we can get the facts.
Well, what we were thinking about, if you remember, Peter, back in the spring, we did have sort of a joint meeting which gave an update on the litigation.
Right.
We would propose to do a follow-up on that to sort of bring you up to speed as to where the litigation stands now.
Yeah, it would be helpful.
And we'd be willing to do that in the near future based on your schedule, and we'll coordinate the Planning Board schedule with your schedule.
Okay, you folks interested in that?
Yes, yes. Please.
Good. Any else? Questions from the board? Comments from the board?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank your committee. Okay. Next, Board of Health. Mary Jane Watson is going to give us the presentation. And you can see how easy the last one was, so we weren't too tough.
Good evening. I'm Mary Jane Watson, known to anybody under 30 as Spider-Man's girlfriend, I think. But for the purposes of this evening, going forward, I have been vice chair of the Board of Health, and I am now acting chairperson because Dr. Stanley Cocott has just resigned from the board. My other colleagues on the board are Frank Boyle, who is here tonight, Pamela Howell, and Dr. Robert Inslee, who
Pam's
could not
here.
Be here tonight.
Yep. Pam's here. Yep, just one.
Right. Did you stand up? Oh, and Pamela. Those are our board members. I think it's important, before I go any further, to give Dr. Stanley Cocott an enormous thank you for his participation. He's been an incredible board member, and I think the longest-serving board member. He's been 14 years on the board. And also, he serves as a delegate to the Water Quality Force, and that he's been on that for 10 years. So his dedication and service to the town of Harwich is remarkable. And he's an incredibly knowledgeable and resourceful human being anyway. He's been wonderful as a leader to us, and his knowledge and depth of knowledge medically, and his also handling of parliamentary procedure has helped be a strong leader, and he has good control over the meetings, so he's done a fabulous job. His passions and a lot of strength has been applied to the tobacco issues. And he feels very strongly about that, obviously, as a physician, and has been very, very strong in his leadership of wanting to strengthen regulations regarding tobacco sales. His other interest is the water quality, and that has been shown in his ability to kind of ride herd on issues that had to do with variances that we were controlling at the board level. I think all in all, I just want to mention that he's a wonderful human being, a wonderful man, and we're going to miss him terribly. He's going to be tough shoes to fill. He's made an enormous contribution. And it goes without saying also that his interest in medicine goes far beyond the local issues to the global ones. So he was always able to fill us in and kept an eye on the issues such as Ebola, mad cow, and things that fortunately haven't touched the Harwich community, but were out there. And so he was always of interest and kept current on everything. The other issue that's big, or has been big for the department this year, has been the Excella computer program that's finally being implemented after a year and a half. And Paula Champagne, who's had to wear so many hats when she was so short-staffed over the last few years, has finally been able to catch up a little bit because they are fully staffed now with a very competent crew. So she's been able to bring things from the back burners onto the front. And the computer program, once fully operational, is going to provide an enormous service to the community. This will allow information and the application process to keep things from being jammed up at the window. A lot will be able to be done online. And that has been a dream of Paula's for a long time, and it's finally coming to fruition. I think mainly any glitches in that or any delays have been due to fine-tuning the software to the needs of the department, and certainly not computer illiteracy, which is what I always encountered in doing them in my other work. Paula has an incredibly competent technical staff now. So if anybody can put this in place as quickly as possible, she can, or her department can. And I'm looking forward to that because I think that's going to save a lot of time. It will decrease her review time by a lot, and it will certainly save time from everybody's standpoint. And particularly the public, I think, will be grateful to that. And I just want to summarize by saying that our board tries very hard to be business friendly. Sometimes we're accused of not being so friendly, but we have to function within the confines of the laws we're trying to use to keep the whole environment healthy and the wonderful place that Harwich has been that we all moved here for. Thank you.
Okay, don't go away yet. So. I would guess that we're down one member, right?
We are down a member. I meant to mention that with a little more emphasis. Yes, we're down.
You need
a
member.
A new board member.
Right. And if anybody's interested in that, what do you think the qualifications are for that? What are you looking for in a member?
Well, knowledge of medical issues is important to some degree. We have a nurse, we have a doctor, we have someone in business. So we've sort of covered the waterfront. From my standpoint, I think any member of the community who is passionate about the issues that he knows will keep the environment safe. I mean, we have to be concerned about services that we provide, and food service is a big one. Someone with that kind of experience might work. Engineers, and you know, I mean, the health board is the health board, but as I say, I think would welcome any point of view that brings in fresh ideas and can understand where we're coming from in terms of having to enforce an environment that is protective.
Sure. Okay. All right. And then through you, could I ask Paula maybe when you're ready with your software, could we have
a demonstration
here? I'd
rather defer to Paula on that anyway.
Yeah.
Because she'll
be the person. We have a demonstration here when you're ready for it. You know, in one of our meetings would be good just so people know what it can do or not do or how to use it.
Yeah.
And I guess my last comment would be, would you like to expand on the Spider-Man comment?
Do you not know?
I do know.
Oh,
but I'm
okay.
She's
not that old.
Well, she said anyone under 30, so.
Wait, don't go away yet. We have questions from the board. Anybody else want to follow up on Spider-Man? No? Okay, Linda.
I think I'd like to echo your comments on Dr. Cocotte. He really is quite the gentleman. I enjoyed when I was liaison to the Board of Health and watching him handle a meeting and his professionalism and politeness, but yet he didn't allow any shenanigans. But
thank you. He's a wonderful human being, and I wish him well. He'll be interested in everything we're doing, probably.
He definitely knew his
stuff.
We
wish he were here.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll try and find you a new member. Okay. You're on it, right?
Yes.
Okay. Housing Committee. Ayla, there you go. All right. Welcome. How are you?
Good evening, members. How are you? I'm chair of the Harwich Housing Committee, and this is my first time presenting, so be nice to me.
The ladies downstairs would like it if you speak into the mic, because then they can hear when they go to do the minutes, they can hear it.
So. Okay. Is that better?
That's good. Thank you.
Okay. This is my first time presenting.
That's okay.
As chair of the Harwich Housing Committee. The committee's been through a lot of changes this year. Jerry Loftus retired, and just recently, a few months ago, David Purdy also resigned from the committee. So those two gentlemen were really the rock of the committee. We, the other members and I, kind of just supported their advocacy for housing, affordable housing in Harwich. So Cindy and Claudia and I have really had to, we have big boots to fill. We're not really sure that we can do that, but we're going to try. We're also down two members, so if anyone knows anyone that is interested in joining, we'd be more than happy to take a look at your candidates. Not that we're going to be picky or selective by all means, but since you touched on it with the Board of Health of what you're looking for in a member, we would just like someone that's passionate and caring about affordable housing, and someone that maybe just has a little knowledge of the history of housing on Cape Cod, because it's really evolving and changing over the years as we have a shift of limited resources for families and individuals to find any rentals on Cape Cod. Any statistics you're interested in, please come to one of our meetings. We'd be happy to share them with you.
And just while you're talking about potential new members, could you just refresh our memories as to how often you meet, when you meet?
Certainly. Right now we're meeting the first Monday of the month at the Town Hall Library at 4:30.
Okay.
And the meetings generally, we try to keep them limited to about an hour.
Okay.
And we are flexible if you know of someone that needs a different time slot. We're open to that as well. We've been very fortunate in the past to have Linda as our liaison, and we were both saddened and shocked when she stepped down. But we are very happy to welcome Janelle, who brings a lot of history to the town of Harwich, so she'll be a great, great support as well. We are really elated that Dave Spitz, Harwich town planner, will continue with us as well. David's support and direction has been instrumental in this committee's vision and purpose. And honestly, without Dave, we wouldn't know what we're doing. So thank you. I'll just share a little bit about what we have plans to do. We really want to keep David Purdy's and Jerry Loftus's vision of the Harwich Housing Committee. We want to keep that alive. But we also know with changing times that we need to change some things. So we really want to inform the public about the need for and the value of affordable housing through public meetings, newspaper columns, public access TV, and videos. I've been on the committee, I think, almost 4 years now, and what I find refreshing is the knowledge that, you know, the members come to bring to the committee. What's shocking is many community residents have no idea what affordable housing is, what's required for affordable housing, and if you're eligible or not. Even recently, I posted on social media that we're working on a big project, which I'll share with you in a little bit here, for affordable housing. And there was a lot of people that have that really could use it but have no idea. So our commitment to the Harwich community is to hold some type of educational forum or something, just so if people aren't sure what affordable housing is and how you access it, that at least they'll have the knowledge. I just don't want a resident out there. I'm a licensed social worker, so it's really important to me that people are educated and that we can bring the support to the community. And a lot of people might not even know, you know, what's available. So that's one thing that we'd like to add to the direction, you know, that Jerry and David had brought for so many years. Just briefly, the programs that are still active and that we're working on the buy-down program. This program is at the second time around here in Harwich. It's for first time, and I don't have to read it because I know the program by heart, but it's for first-time home buyers where they can receive money toward the purchase of a home if they meet the eligibility requirements. The income they receive to help them with their purchase of the home does not have to be returned to them. It's like a grant. It's anywhere, it used to be a little more, but say $70,000. Say you find a home for $200,000 in Harwich. This program will give you $75,000 toward the purchase of that home. So it helps the homeowner better qualify and be able to get their foot in the door of a property. If I'm wrong, Dave, you can stop me. But we've been working really hard to bring that program back, and we're working with John Stewart at the Harwich Housing Authority, because he's getting the state eligibility requirements. So we're almost at the advertisement step portion of that program. It's been going on, I think, Linda, almost a year now when we received permission to move forward with this. So we will keep on top of that. You know, the committee is really passionate about that, to bring that opportunity. And I believe we have enough funds for two families to find a home in Harwich and get a substantial down payment that they don't have to return. And of course, there's eligibility requirements, but we'll have, you know, public information about it. So that's the buy down program. We're really excited about that. We'll also continue funding for the rental assistance program. That's an ongoing program right now in Harwich and Chatham, where if you if your family or is in within the 80% medium of income, just like for an example, a household size of four, you have to make under $58,000. So you can apply for rental assistance where for 3 years you can get up to $350 off your rent or mortgage. This helps you stay in your home and save, or, you know, work toward something. But I think it's a great program, and it's also in the second time that they're offering this. Again, a lot of community residents, people in Harwich, they do not know of the program. It's not for lack of presenting or advertising. People just don't have the knowledge that these programs are available. So that's another reason why our committee is really focused the next year to bring, you know, the attention to what is actually available for people that live or work in Harwich. I just think it's important. So if you hear a lot about it, we really want to, like, kill it out there.
We'd like to hear a lot about it. Yeah.
Good.
That'd be a
great.
Good thing. Yeah.
Excellent. So we have a brand new project that we're working on, and thanks to Robin and Janelle, I was able to get the packet into CPC right at the deadline. It's going to be called the Kelly Project, and right now we're working with landowners in North Harwich who are interested in selling 3.2 acres of property to us for the sole purpose of building affordable housing. And we have reached out to several resources as well as Habitat, who is interested as well. So that will be our top priority with the buy-down program this year. And thank you. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned you're down two members. Is that, that's okay, two, that's all right. So we will start advertising that and trying to find you some members.
That'd be great.
Let's get the word out there. I mean, it's important to do that. And as you said, you're flexible with the meeting time.
Absolutely.
If someone has a
yes,
conflict.
Sir.
Mm-hmm. It's more important to get the person involved than it is to sit yeah. there at a set time, right? So
exactly. Like I was really excited to meet today, this evening, for our monthly meeting, because we didn't have it in September due to the holiday. But I had one member ill, so I couldn't even meet. So it's really important to at least get one more on board. But we'd hope for two.
Let's get two. Yeah. Okay. Questions from the board?
Yep. One quick question. Mela, you said the rental assistance that you're speaking of, mm-hmm. also for mortgage payments. So is that available for homeowners? And so it's not technically rental assistance, but
that's correct.
Housing payment assistance?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Good to know.
They'll do both. That's right. Yes. In the past, the first time they ran the program, which was, I want to say, like 2008, they assisted 65 households to help pay over a three-year period. But I believe now they'll do both rent and mortgage.
Okay,
wow.
Michael.
I just asked about the Willow Street property that was designated for affordable housing in 2001, and it's still in, and it
okay.
says in the notes it's still in limbo.
Mm-hmm. Yes, let's see what I have.
Seems like
they
we
signed
could probably figure
Willow
that
Street,
one out.
Should the housing committee get resolution on contested boundaries? So I think it was a boundary issue with that property. It was under old business, but let me double check. Yes.
David Spitz.
Yeah, I think, Lindy, I think you know a lot of the background, but this one has had some real property issues, and it's a very convoluted title wherein we bought originally from the heirs, from two of the heirs, but not four of the heirs. What it would take to fix that is probably quite a bit of work. I've actually advised the Housing Committee that they should spend more time on other sites. But it could be resurrected. It's just not an easy one.
So,
but it's also there's a multiple issues because isn't
yeah,
there also, there's the person who built the shed or the garage on town property. So, you know, maybe we can carve that out and get that resolved and try to do it in pieces rather than the whole thing.
Yeah,
because I don't see that. I mean, that should move one way or the other, because at this point, you know.
I would suggest at some point we put it on the agenda.
Yeah, we actually, we did look into this, and there are two property boundary issues, two houses that have issues, and we did have the surveyor go out, draw some lines, and the our former real estate attorney, Attorney Ford, was working on that to try to come up with some kind of resolution of those property boundary issues. But I think we have to get the boundary issues resolved to kind of be able to progress. So I know in my time here that I did ask them to start that. I do need to follow up and find out where they are so we can keep moving it forward.
Okay, we'll put on the agenda at some point in time, Chris, when
yep.
you're ready, and Lisa, we can refresh our memories as to what the issues are and how we can move forward on it. So, anybody else? Linda?
Also, as part of that, there is that CPC article from 3 years ago that did $50,000 for tax title work, and none of that money has been spent, and there seems to be some issues as to how to spend it that came up afterwards, et cetera.
Yes.
So if that could be also brought up at the same time
yes.
and get where we are in that, because that money otherwise is just sitting there.
Right.
And it should get spent.
I have that on my to-do list even before that came up, because I am following up on that to try to get an opinion from the attorney that I think we can just go forward with that, but the attorney raised an issue, so I just wanna make sure we vet that out.
Okay.
But I think we're, you know, hopefully days away from being able to move forward with that.
It's only 3 years old, so.
I've only been here a little less than two, so.
Chris, let's put both of us together to come back to us at some point when you're ready.
I just have one
not in the too distant future, or not too far from now, please. to know.
I just have one more question.
Yep.
Is Mr. McGillan still on the committee? You guys haven't heard from him, or?
No, the status of John is we need to present a letter to the Board of Selectmen to have him removed. We followed the channels where we sent email, snail mail, and phone message.
Now, will that create a third opening?
That is the second.
Yeah. Okay.
So you need to clear that out and before we can appoint the second person, if we have a second person.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Anybody else? All good? Thank you. Thank you for your committee, too.
Thank you.
You did a good job presenting, by the way. Don't worry.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Good. All right. Moving on to Board of Selectmen's FY's 2017 budget message. I'll just point out to everybody that we're about to enter the budget season. What does that mean? There'll be a lot of time spent between now and annual town meeting in May getting all the information and data collected for the budget, put together, assembled, brought before the Finance Committee, the Board of Selectmen, et cetera, et cetera. There'll be lots and lots of discussions and presentations to us over that period of time. But to kick it all off, it's our requirement in the charter to give some guidance to the town administrator, and that's what this FY 2017 budget message is about. And I'll just read it. It says, Dear Chris, Town Charter Section 9-2-2 requires that the Board of Selectmen provide a budget message on or before the first Tuesday in October to guide the town administrator in the development of the budget for the fiscal year ahead. The lack of projected planned savings associated with regionalizing our school system and the challenges of employees' health care benefits have put significant pressure on the municipal budget in recent years. In an effort to continue to provide high-quality municipal services and improve our equipment and facilities, we have increasingly relied on capital and debt exclusions, which the voters have on many occasions supported, although this approach has allowed us to technically stay within the confines of Proposition 2.5, our taxpayers continue to pay more. We have also enjoyed reasonable growth, which has generated new revenues to support our expenditures. Consistent with the most recent town administrator goals and objectives, the FY 2017 budget needs to stay within the limits of Proposition 2.5 plus forecasted growth. The use of capital debt exclusions to satisfy items typically supported via the budget shall be minimized. Any and all items proposed outside of 2.5 and growth shall be rank ordered with priority justification. Specifically, any and all additions to personnel, either hours and their people, must be within the limits of Prop 2.5 and not detract from building maintenance. To help effectively manage our department budgets, we suggest the allocation of indirect costs to each department. This will provide us, the Board of Selectmen, with a better understanding of the total cost to operate each of our departments as we continue to match fees with services. It is necessary to review total department costs, including those that are carried by another department, the DPW, for instance, when determining fees. If planned expenses are not covered through fees, an article should be developed for town meeting so that the taxpayers can determine if they are willing to use property taxes to fund these expenditures. Significant improvements to the water and land sides of Sagatucket Harbor are actively being pursued. Harbor income surplus funds should be used to offset the payments associated with repayment of these funds over time as debt service. We recommend the development of a payment cash flow schedule spread over the life of the debt repayment to guide the consideration of user fees once the facilities have been improved. In this manner, the users will pay for the improvements which they enjoy, not the taxpayers. Therefore, beginning with the 2017 budget, any excess waterway revenues in excess of appropriate costs should be placed in a waterways capital fund rather than free cash. As we prepare to move forward with our comprehensive wastewater management plan covering a 40-year span, the taxpayers will shoulder a $200+ million burden. Wastewater will be funded through a combination of real estate taxes, infrastructure funding, enterprise funding, and user fees. In reality, these are taxes to be paid by taxpayers in addition to existing real estate taxes and fees. As discussed on several occasions, the Board of Selectmen has a keen and active interest in providing for the proper maintenance of our facilities, For too long, we have used building facility maintenance as the buffer to balance the budget. This segment of the budget needs to be adequately funded so as to preserve our municipal assets and improve their operational efficiency wherever feasible. In the process of developing the 2017 budget, we believe it is appropriate to manage building maintenance by consolidating all department maintenance into a single building maintenance account under the control of Sean Libby. We encourage you to manage expectations in the process of soliciting and integrating individual department requests for FY 2017. As a board, we are prepared to assist you in this process, and we look forward to better understanding the priorities and working through the difficult yet necessary task of saying no. And it's the Harwich Board of Selectmen. So I think, Chris, I'll say a few things first, and that is, you know, we're looking to live within 2.5 plus growth. I think that was part of your goals and objectives. We're looking to obviously focus on maintenance, and that's something that has come to the forehead in the last couple of years. And I would say with the harbor, I think we all have to realize that the harbor over, you know, in recent history, probably for a lot of its history, has contributed money to the general operation of the town. We're not asking in this case just to stop that and put all the money into the harbor. There is a certain amount of money that the harbor, you know, throws out each year, I will say, or spins off, that we would expect to still stay in helping the cause of the general, you know, general fund, if you will, a general budget. But what we're talking about is, you know, new monies and potentially increased fees as a result of what gets done with, you know, $7 million in waterside improvements and a couple million dollars in landside improvements in those items. So I think you have a challenge. We think it's doable. I think that getting ourselves sort of off the capital and debt exclusion stuff would be helpful. Just because, again, you know, people are paying that tax. It is a tax, there's no doubt about it. So with that, I'll open it up to the board, and then I'd like to hear your response as to how challenging or how easy this will be. Okay. Anybody on the board? Anybody happy? Linda.
Am I ever happy?
No.
No.
That's why I looked your way.
In terms of the harbor, that paragraph, what you just said in terms of it would be additional waterways revenue, etc., and that's not what this last line says. This last line says any excess of waterways revenue in excess of cost should be placed. So is it? So I'm a little confused as to this sentence and what you just said.
My interpretation of this, since I wrote it, with some input from everybody, is that we need to be reasonable in getting ourselves transitioned here. Paying for $7 million plus is a huge item. First of all, we have to see if the taxpayers want to do it, you know, by going through town meeting. I do think at some point in time, as we start to generate additional revenues out of the water activity, waterways activities, that those funds should be used to help the debt service.
Okay, but again, that's not what this says.
I understand.
So
that.
Can we somehow, because I just saw this draft by not being here, I just saw this draft Friday, and I hadn't seen it. I hadn't seen that piece of it, so.
There's some language you'd like to propose to change there.
Yes, yeah, something about if it's, you know, excess of existing waterways revenues or something. But I'd also, in terms of this, before I'd personally be willing to support this, because I think that this is a big change for us, I'd actually like to see if Chris would run through fiscal year, you know, 6/30/14, which ended, you know, what are the revenues that came in, you know, actual versus budget, what would be the you know, pilot payment you would pit against the, what would be the allocation of a, you know, the you know, benefits, et cetera, and insurance, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, come down to a number so we actually have an idea of what we're talking about. Because if we have $1.5 million of free cash and we're talking about taking X dollars of that and putting it somewhere, then that means with our unrequited thirst for spending every dime we can get. All it means is that we'll have more capital exclusions and more debt exclusions, because we're certainly not going to stop the projects, and we're not going to say no to stuff. So I have a fear of taking money out of free cash and then charging the taxpayers even more. So I'd like to actually see those numbers run, so we have an idea of what we're talking about. I mean, so that, is it going to be to a maximum of this dollar value? What does that mean?
And I actually think that during the process of preparing and going through the budget, I would expect that in all these cases, Chris is going to come back with what it means, whether it's the maintenance stuff, whether it's the harbor stuff, everything. I would hope he's going to develop the scenarios under which, you know, it's going to go this way, that way, here's my recommendation, sort of
but
thing.
But I would definitely like that harbor calculation for 6/30/14, so we have a starting point as to what we think we're talking about, actual versus budget. I mean, all that stuff is in Munis, so this shouldn't be a big deal to calculate.
Mr. Chairman, if unless there's any other questions from the board, I would like to at least comment. Just in terms of some of these, obviously, I think that we're in a similar mindset to the approach, and certainly I understand. I will try to deliver on as many of these as I can. Just to talk about a couple things, you know, in my mind, when we say Prop 2.5 plus forecasted growth, that's about 3.25 in my mind, so that's approximately where I will be targeting. Also, I just was curious on the, it says specifically any and all additions to personnel that they would be not, you know, within 2.5 and not detract from building maintenance. I think in the time that I've been here, I've presented two budgets, and the personnel people that I've put in or recommended be put in have been within Proposition 2.5. In my mind, for priority, and this was a board priority last year, and I just want to kind of make sure that we at least have a discussion about it, that I think Sean Libby, you know, doing some consolidation and bringing some people in, that department had requested 6 new bodies be added to them. We were only able to fund one, and that was using some of the revenue that he had from other existing positions. But in my mind, you know, if we're going to add any new personnel in order of priority, I kind of have Sean Libby in that building maintenance as kind of number one on the list. The second one on the list was the board had mentioned at the right at the budget time last year when we were finalizing the budget that the police had a need as well. And so in my mind, police would be second in terms of order of priority. And then almost a perpetual would be the fire department. How many of these we can actually afford within the budget, you know, will remain to be seen. But in my mind, that's kind of a priority list that I have moving
Chris,
forward.
Chris, I think we got down to it last year on personnel on the police department. Mm-hmm. I think for last year I was pushing to get done. But what I remember hearing from the rest of the board at that time was that we all knew we were going to get a new police chief. And I think they're waiting to hear his feedback. So I think, you know, based on what you know, David comes back with in his budget, then you know, I think it does strong consideration.
Okay, I'm just again, these are kind of some of the things I see as I look at the tea leaves moving forward.
Yep.
On the indirect costs analysis, we did do an indirect cost analysis and did distribute that, you know, to the board members, and recreation was one of the ones. I'm a little concerned in regards to continue to match fees with services. I think we came out and, you know, it was pretty clear that the recreation department, and I think you'll see this even in the revenue, that they were able to offset their direct costs, but their indirect costs are probably as substantial as their direct. And that would mean a real fundamental change in the way we do recreation. To try to have that be all fee driven versus right now the hybrid of some fee and some taxpayer. So, you know, that you know, the water department came back as basically being self-sufficient with fees and revenues. Golf came back as self-sufficient. Harbors, contrary to kind of the actual study of that, is a little bit of a different one, where they did the total revenue that they generated was offset by the total expenses that the town had. The difference was that, and the best example of this is on, we did a capital exclusion for dredging that was $350,000. So that's $175,000 a year for 2 years. That $175,000 wasn't offset by fees. It was actually done as a capital exclusion. So, you know, the costs are related. Will we be able to take all those and shift those in without creating too much budget disruption? You know, that's going to be a little bit of work to see what we're able to do. But when you look at the total costs, when that indirect cost analysis was done, in terms of the harbor, the town does spend and have, and it doesn't, it makes sense to me. There's so many issues at the harbor that we're in the middle of a reconstruction plan of harbors that have been neglected, for lack of a better term, for several years. So with kind of the building boom. So I just, you know, obviously the goal is to get as much as we can and to have things be self-sufficient as we can. So again, these are just primarily initial reactions to some of these comments. On the Sacotucket Harbor, I did present a plan last year on funding the design, in which about 25% came from fees related. I think that 25% was philosophically carried through to the $7 million. So in my mind, we'll keep it at around that 25%, because I think otherwise the fee structure would be too much out of whack and we would have negative implications. But I think what I presented last year certainly will be a place that I will build upon.
Chris, I also think, let's just talk about the harbor for a second. We talk about fees now at the harbor. Mm-hmm. I think that until those new facilities are in place, someone can actually walk down the new dock, if you will, right, it's going to be hard to assess them a fee in anticipation of doing that, you know what I mean? So there's going to be, I don't know what it is, a year, 18 months, 2 years while this process goes on. We've got to raise the money, mm-hmm, but you're not going to really, I don't think, fairly raise fees until you actually had the facility done, so you can say to people, now you're getting the benefit of having, you know, this new facility, if you will.
Yeah, and I think we will be able to accomplish a lot of that, because the way debt service does that, really you don't make full payments on debt service until a year after the project goes out. So I think timing-wise, we should be able to time that out. I know we've had discussions, Mr. Chairman, and I'm in agreement on that. Comprehensive wastewater, you know, I did the initial attempt at the last the five-year projection to kind of start to talk about at least the philosophy that we'll adopt in terms of that. And then on the building maintenance, certainly I appreciate the board putting in there to try to encourage departments to consolidate. We do have a little bit of a flat organization in some respects, and we'll do what we can to get the departments to consolidate. I think Mr. Libby has done an outstanding job, and I think consolidating, giving him the ability to do that. I'd also like to add, I know this has been brought up, to see if we can consolidate and then try to add, whether it's 25 or 50,000, some amount to try to help him get a head start on some of these things. So that's kind of the mindset that I have going into the
process. Yeah, we look forward to the plan that would accompany that. You know, what is the plan?
Sure.
You know, as you go through, Linda had her hand up first, I believe.
Just that while we did it, I do recall the indirect cost study, and it was a lot of work to it. But I think this budget message is to now start journal entering it into Munis and allocating those costs directly in Munis, so that when we pull a profit, you know, a departmental expense report, we then don't have to take Excel spreadsheets and start adding this and adding that and adding this and adding that. There should be a way, you know, this is not that difficult to do. And I'm perfectly happy to sit down and, you know, I did this through the retail industry for 25 years. So this is pretty easy to do what I think needs to be accomplished. And it's not that hard. And it can be done without making an enormous project out of it. So I'm perfectly happy to sit with you and Andy and go through it and our new assistant and just outline how this could work painlessly.
Yeah, I think the only reason why I didn't comment on that is that I really need to sit down with Andy to talk through how we can do that in Munis. I think what you're recommending is on the health insurance budget, as an example, that we would no longer have a standalone health insurance budget, but allocate those costs to departments. And, you know, the only, I do have a little bit of concern with that, because I think in some cases you're going to see some departments, you have, may have two departments that are identical from a staffing standpoint, and if two people in one department take health insurance and two people in another do not, then the indirect costs for one is going to be 5% perhaps, and the indirect cost for the other is going to be 35%. And
I think you're making it way more complicated than you need to. Take it as a percentage of payroll straight across the board, and you don't really worry about this person is on family plan, and then we change from family plan to a single. I think you're making it way too complicated. It's really simple.
My suggestion there is that, Chris, why don't you sit with Andy?
Yeah, we'll have a discussion.
And why don't you guys sit down with Linda and go through it and see if you can come back to us with what a reasonable approach is.
I just, I have to do the fund accounting that happens in government, so I can't always translate everything that private does to government. But as much as we can, I'm willing to do it, as long as Andy's comfortable too with the accounting element of it.
Okay. It's simple. All right.
Michael?
Could you send me the indirect cost study? I haven't seen that.
I think it was completed before the election, so yeah, we'll send that.
And then in terms of REC, since you mentioned REC, mm-hmm. Does the study break down what the indirect costs are?
Because yes, it does.
I agree with you on the, I don't think we can account for all of that money into the REC budget. So I'd like to see the breakdown in the study.
There are certain things we do as a government.
Right.
That you're never gonna cover the cost.
Right.
They have to be supplemented. So
and we're gonna mow the fields no matter what.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I just want to manage expectations, because I don't want to create a fear factor of people thinking that we're going to be scaling down a rec. So
it's more than anything. It's really two parts. It's the allocate the costs out so you have a true cost to the department, and then the fee discussion. How much do you want to charge in fees? But having the total cost sitting there, at least have an understanding what the total cost is, because we inevitably end up discussing, does this have benefits, doesn't it have, what's the load, how much is insurance, and we start going through all of this, and it's really two parts. But I agree with you, Michael, we don't want to take the rec department and say, you've got to raise another $150 billion in terms of fees.
Okay, anybody else? So Chris, we'll look forward to your initial shot at the budget, let's put it that way, which that's just the beginning of the process. And I just remind my fellow board members, it goes on for a long time, the whole process. So that's what it's all about. Okay, we'll move on to new business. We have Chris.
When you feel it, I will recuse myself.
Yes, okay.
Item
right,
A.
Thank you.
We do have a representative here from Habitat for Humanity.
Do you want her to run through it?
Maybe I'll do a quick overview and then I'll offer the representative.
I guess the real question from me, is just an explanation of why we're doing this.
Yeah, why we're doing this is town meeting had approved for the town to acquire this property. So Habitat had a turnaround, for lack of a better term. And that turnaround piece of property was going to be dedicated to the town of Harwich. An issue emerged in which under the ownership, they would turn over the property once they started selling houses. The roadway would become part of the homeowners association. In my experience, it's somewhat difficult to deal with homeowners associations, especially when you're in the process of selling homes and getting a development going. So there's been a request to move forward with having the town accept the roadway, but it's not yet fully complete. So what you have in front of you is documents that allow for the acceptance of the roadway with the understanding that there is also a covenant to, I think it's $12,000, that this allows Habitat to go ahead and start selling homes. It allows the town to accept the improvements that will be coming, and if for some reason the improvements don't happen, which I don't think that's going to happen in this case, we have protections in place to finish the section of the roadway that the town anticipated that it would receive. So we're doing a little bit more documentation in order to try to comply with some timelines for sale of other properties and to kind of make this work.
Okay, so I just back up so everybody out there knows. We're talking about the Habitat project off of, on Oak Street.
On Oak Street.
That has, in the process of getting 7 houses put together. Each of those houses has a lot, so there'd be lots, 1 through 7. And this is associated with what they call Lot 8, which is the turnaround.
Right.
The rest of it, right? And anybody that's been up there, you can certainly see there's asphalt and there's, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And it looks to me, if I remember the numbers in here, the whole, I'll just call it holdback or retainer, was something like $12,000.
Correct.
So it's not a hugely extensive amount of work that needs to get done.
Mm-hmm.
What I didn't know was, because when I read through this without a really good explanation, it almost sounded like we were behind on the schedule, and we just, in order to get that first house going, we wanted to get this one, you know, get this this matter resolved.
I think it's just more of a product of, in a roadway acceptance, normally you wouldn't accept a roadway until it was totally complete.
Right.
And in this case, that, I guess, the binder coat's down with the top coat.
I could give us, you want me to give a little clarification?
Sure.
To this? I think actually it was like a problem created by the fact that the whole project is due, if it stays on schedule, which it, without unusual external circumstances, should be completed and all sold in April. That's our plan. And the idea was the town had already agreed to take lot 8, but that we would have that top coated before we sold the first house, which would be fine, except that then one house was selected for a blitz build and we're ready to sell that house now, and it's not reasonable to put the top coat on before the rest of the project is finished. So this lets us sell the home that is completed rather than leaving that vacant, with the promise that we will top coat and to have the town take lot 8 now, with the promise that we will top coat it, you know, before we sell the rest of the houses. But one of the agreements does give the selectmen sole discretion, you know, to release any of the other lots should they want to. And the $12,000 is your security that we will do that top coat work. So that's the essence. I did want to say this project had a lot of evolution to it, but ultimately there will not be a homeowners association because we're on a town road. That's the reason that there is the town is taking lot 8 rather than the homeowners holding that. That would have been the only land in common. So.
Okay, that was a good explanation.
So, yeah, this will allow us to go forward with the closing on that house on Wednesday.
Okay, Chris, has town council looked at this?
Yeah, actually town council drafted all the documents along with the council for Habitat.
Okay.
So they're both in agreement.
Okay, all right. Anybody want to make a motion?
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve the request by Habitat for Humanity to accept the deed to the road, Lot 8, and approve the covenant passbook agreement and indemnification agreement for Oak Street development.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to grant the request. Further discussion? Hearing none, we'll put it to a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. It's a vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You guys can sign all these things as well. Okay, we're going to wastewater educational moment. I asked Chris to give us an update on the construction schedule for Muddy Creek, which I believe has changed.
Do you want to have Linda come back since?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, is she hiding? Sorry.
It's not that she's dying to hear this. But
oh, no. I forgot she's in the room. It's all good.
The two pieces of material that was in the package, the first is kind of the contract time determination. This is all in regards to the Muddy Creek restoration project on Route 28. Again, just to remind people that basically the project is to remove the culvert and replace it with a bridge. In this circumstance, you have 252 calendar days, or approximately 8 months. Due to the nature of how work needs to be done on the Cape, you really can't work in the summertime because that's really high tourist season. So in this case, we're running a little contrary to how the rest of the state does business. We will be doing some work, primarily a lot of the work in the winter. So the typical winter shutdown that exists in other parts of the state will not exist here, and the Cape actually does a lot of the work in the fall, winter, and spring instead of in summertime. So this kind of lays out the timeline of what the work will be. Just in terms of some of these things, notice to proceed is really the kickoff. We have issued the notice to proceed on the project. We have not received, we have milestone dates and access. Maybe we can call up the next one. Just the goal is to have this done prior to next summer, so the target date for completion is to have it done by Memorial Day. Just here in the project sequence, we're currently looking at the utilities to get the utilities relocated. There's a lot of temporary utilities that have to go in. And then they have basically the east half construction. They would take and dig down half of it, build half of a support structure, and then do the west half, and then come in and put the bridge superstructure on top of those two supports once they're in place. So you can see that that's kind of the phasing of the work that's going to be done. I think the span is about 120 feet, so it's a fairly lengthy span, but they will prefab those and truck them in and place those in place. In order to go through the process, there's a what's called a critical path analysis that we do have an example of that. This was a critical path that was provided by the contractor, MAS. It's really just a very quick and dirty estimate of what and how things will flow for the project. We do need to formally meet with them and finalize a process that has, I think if we can call that up, it shows kind of some of the items, preparation of the material, preparation of the site, the location, bringing in the material. Here they literally in these things identify the various milestones that they need to meet, and they have dates. So the idea is that they kind of have the work flow in a way in which it's sequenced to be able to complete in a timely fashion. For instance, we did already have the board award the contract, and I think the day that the contract was awarded or the day after, the steel was ordered for the bridge superstructure. So the lead time on some of these things take a considerable amount. We do believe, too, the other, because this is a environmentally sensitive area, we are also trying to juggle in some of the issues in which different fish spawn during certain times of the year. So we need to be sensitive to time of year construction and at least provide for the ability to fish to migrate if need be. So this kind of lays out the process. Again, this is really just a draft work. Plan. We hope to have a more finalized work plan in November, December timeline when they're going to really commence doing the work. But I think the road closure will probably be start in December or January once they start getting in and digging. But you can kind of see it. This is actually called a critical path analysis, just the different types of work that needs to be done and how does it get accomplished and what time span. So once we have a final plan in place with the contractor, we're happy to show that so people have a much better sense for where we are. But right now, our primary focus has been on getting the utilities out there to put the temporary relocations in place. That has gone, I think, reasonably well. I think some of that work you'll see done in October. That should not lead to road closures. One other positive piece that we just received today, as a matter of fact, there's one property as part of this project that would have a flooding impact on Sugar Hill. Mm-hmm. Sugar Hill. And in that area, we'll have the board for the next board meeting for you, the board, to sign off. We have reached a mitigation agreement with the homeowner. Literally, the water, because of the project, would come up in certain storms, and just basically the storm that we're going to have an impact would be any storm that's up to the 22 and a half year storm, and anything over that, it would top over 28 in that area. So the impact is going to be the impact irregardless of what we do with the bridge project. But that mitigation between basically a 10-year storm and a 22-year storm, we do have to mitigate that impact onto the residents.
So we do have that material. We have reached agreement, and that will be presented to the board for execution at the next meeting. That's kind of critical. I was on a phone call last week or the week before, in which we are in the running for a grant. I think if the board recalls, this project is somewhat tight in terms of funding, and if everything goes well, we should be in good shape. But not everything usually goes well on these projects. So we are in the running for a grant, and I know the grant agency was very concerned about where we were with that agreement. So now that we have that, I think it'll put us even in better shape to potentially obtain that grant. And just for folks, as a reminder, that this project is a project that is 50% funded by the town of Harwich and 50% funded by the town of Chatham, literally on the town line between the two towns. So it is something that has been a very good project for regionalization, if you want to call it that.
So Chris, just so I can understand, there's an item under temporary utility locations, just for maybe you can bring it down. It's up further on
draw
the chart.
Draw it down a little bit.
Yeah. Well, it's up further, I think.
Jamie, if you could.
You go down.
You go down, and we need to see up.
We need to see up. Yeah, you're going. Yeah, there you go. Keep going. Hey, temporary. There you go. Utilities. Temporary utility location. There's an item U153. I'm just picking that one out because it has a finish date of October 5th, which is today.
Mm-hmm.
And that is to remove an existing 6-inch gas line by National Grid. And then the November 13th date is I guess that's the last date you can do it by without disrupting the schedule, is the way I read it, according to their chart here. So I'm just asking the question out of ignorance. Has that now been done, or is that something they're going to do by November 13th?
No, this is, like I said at the beginning, this is actually a draft. So we did have a meeting with the utilities and MAS, and we did work out a updated schedule with the utilities that they would come in and do the work. Our goal, our final goal, I think, is really to kind of get all the utility work done prior to December 1st. Because that's when the contractor's kind of planning on coming in December. So some of these dates were kind of just sequencing dates to get a sense for the timing, but we did have a meeting with the utilities, and this is why I said this is something that's a work in process that we need to have updated.
Okay, so just to clarify, we sort of expected they were gonna get started by now, physically, right? That they would be out there doing something? No?
No. We anticipate that the latest timeline from our initial meeting with MAS is that all the utility work would be done in October and November, which we're slated to have that done. So we do the utility relocations, basically getting out of the way so the contractor can come in and dig, literally dig. And then in December, the contractor will come in and start doing site mobilization. And then probably in January, site mobilization is basically they bring in the equipment, set up trailers, bring in the equipment to get started. They got to do hay bales on the site to make sure that we don't have any materials going into the wetlands. So they'll prep the site, and then the actual hardcore construction will occur in January. The contractor could have said to us, if their schedule allowed, they could have said, well, we want to start on October 15th. They've decided that they want to go more towards wintertime.
Okay. The reason I say this is the last time we talked about this, you know, one of these meetings, mm-hmm. my recollection is that they were going to be closing the road down in early December.
That's still the plan, December.
Okay.
Maybe even into January.
Okay. So I guess the question becomes, I think what we're most interested in, at least I am, making sure we get this done before the summer, you know, before Memorial Day next year is what.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's all of our.
So when I look at it and I see us losing front end time, I guess I'll call it, I just get a little bit worried. Not being in this business, I don't know. But what you're telling us, I think, is he's ordered his materials, the steel, the long lead stuff, and he'll be ready to go and crank on a schedule. So what I would expect is that we maybe by December 1st would see an actual schedule
yes.
that will reflect what he's actually going to do.
Yes.
And we will all pray for no snow, I guess. Okay. All right. No, I get it. So folks, we won't expect to see any road closure out there, at least into well into December, I guess, is the way to say it at the moment. and maybe even a little bit later than that.
Correct.
And the only activity out there at the moment is most likely utility crews when and if they are relocating either electric or gas. Or
yeah, I think you'll probably see some utility crews even this week or next week. Yeah. I think one of them wanted to go in and start doing the work.
Okay.
But again, that would be a lane closure as opposed to a road closure.
I understand. Yeah. Okay, any questions from the board? Okay. All right. Thank you for bringing this to our attention.
Thank you.
Okay, town administrator's report.
So I do have several things this evening. Just to kind of, last time I think I had alluded to that Friends of Harwich Beaches, that they had filed an appeal to our Conservation Commission order. We spent a lot of time at town meeting, this past town meeting on this topic. And just where we are, the town had a path to the sea that was 6 feet wide. That path has deviated over time and basically has gone on to private property. The town did make a commitment that it would relocate the path back onto town property, and that we would do that where some sections of the path are literally, let's say, 3 feet wide. And we had agreed that we would put in just simple planking so people would have, you know, more distinguished path to follow. And in that, we would be able to actually minimize the amount of disturbance to the dunes. In that plan that the Conservation Commission did approve, the Friends of Harwich Beaches, that small group, did file an appeal. The appeal went to DEP, and I think they filed also in Superior Court. And so we basically engaged in litigation over, can we do this? What they were proposing is that they wanted to have a boardwalk constructed, actually a raised platform over the dunes, and put that in. Really, you know, my mind, contrary to trying to minimize the impact on the environment, it seems like it would have a greater impact on it. So long story short, the DEP ultimately agreed with our Conservation Commission and said, yes, that makes sense to take the approach that the Conservation Commission had laid out. And the Friends of Harwich Beaches came out and said, well, that's what we anticipate would happen. And if that's what happens, then they said that they would not further appeal. So I think that our next step in this process is that I did obtain a quote from the vendor to help us construct that. Actually, the time of year to do that work is now October, November, because it's kind of the end of growing season. So it's now the time to get in and do some of that. So the two options that we have, Amy from our conservation director, she has indicated that we can do it, in which she'll go with the effort and help to relocate that with the with volunteers. Or we can use, I think it was Wilkinson Environmental, have them come in and get an update on the quote. The quote's probably over a year old at this point because the litigation took longer than anticipated. And I'll put together some kind of plan and present it probably in the next week or so with Amy, just to let the board know what direction we're headed in. But that just gives a sense for where we've been and where we hope to go. But ultimately, what the final product should be is a smaller, narrower path to the sea that would be included within the town's town-owned 6-foot-wide path.
Okay.
I don't know if there's any questions on that, because I know there's a lot of material.
Sounds like there's two options, Wilkinson Restoration or volunteers. Is that where we're
correct
at?
Okay.
I just have a quick question.
The Wilkinson number, I think, was about $5,000 to do the restoration.
And the question is, how many volunteers actually show up and volunteer? I mean, I don't know how well organized that is.
This would actually be, Amy is plugged into
AmeriCorps.
Thank you. That name wasn't coming to me. Is plugged into AmeriCorps. So that maybe she may be able to get, I don't want to say real volunteers, but concentrated volunteers, for lack of a better term, to come in and try to do this work.
I think if she can get it done in a timely manner, I'd vote for that. But
well, I think it would be more the cost-effective way of doing
it.
Yeah,
sure.
And I don't think the work is that extensive.
Do you know?
Yeah. I'm curious if you know how big the beach beyond this pathway, the public beach, is.
6 foot wide.
So it's basically a 6 foot corridor.
Correct.
All the way down. So
it goes all the way to the water.
Okay.
That's what was deeded to us.
Yep.
a 6-foot wide path to the water.
Yeah, and the problem is over time it's kind of gone like that.
Gotcha.
Thank you.
Next.
Yeah, just a couple other things. I have had some discussions with the folks up on the second floor here in the Community Development Department, as well as the Harwich Employee Association. So we have come up with and resolved some issues related to the golf reorganization. I know some of these things were things that were done literally almost 6 months ago, and some of these things just now are kind of coming to final resolution. So sometimes things take a lot longer than they probably should, but it is what it is. So we have reached resolution on the golf reorganization and the board secretary coverage at the Community Development Department. Both of these things were items that came up as part of the reorg plan for these departments, and as part of the presentation to the board, it was indicated that this would have an impact onto the unionized workforce and that we had to discuss that. So those discussions have finally come to some resolution. There is a probably one more that we will need to do, which is actually we've changed the office layout and we have come up with a new workflow plan for how work will be done. I thought we had a very productive meeting, so hopefully that will be the last hurdle in this to get that squared away. So that's something that we'll get that as the last piece. Also, just for kind of upcoming events, I did meet with Bob Hartwell, who and his wife were the people that put forth the petition for the plastic bag bylaw. So I will be putting together a implementation plan for how we approach that, you know, to do that and then bring that to the board. That's one where town meeting did vote it, and the bylaw was approved by the Attorney General, I think at the end of August. So it's just a matter of we need to figure out how we're gonna put that in place. There was a grace period built into the bylaw that gave people, I believe, a year. So they would have basically a year from September 1st. But I just wanna make sure we get people enough notice to make sure that they know that it's coming. And Mr. Hartwell has done a tremendous amount of work on it. I thought it made sense to kind of invite him into the process to assist in that. And he has agreed. He was very, very interested in participating. Also, just I have been exceptionally busy. We've been negotiating, actually, as I was listing this off. Currently, we're in active negotiations with four unions. So we are making some progress in that area. So it's my hope that we'll have some agreements to be bringing back to the board. The negotiations so far have gone pretty well. Obviously, as any negotiation, sometimes there's some moments of tenseness and then you work through those, but we are making some pretty good progress. I think the only union I have not yet met with, and I think they've asked to schedule, is the managers. For some reason, the managers have always been kind of a lagging union here, so we will get started on negotiations with them as well. I don't mean that anything other than just time sequence, that's where they come up. And then also on, I've received the capital budget requests. It's a lot more extensive than I would have hoped for, but we do have a lot of capital budget requests. I'm in the process of assimilating that information now, and hopefully for the next meeting, I'll pass out the summary of those requests. So, you know, I look at the budget message and think about, you know, fiscal restraint, and yet we still get a tremendous amount of requests for projects. So it just means we're gonna have to say no a lot more this year, perhaps. But anyway, just that was one thing that was a surprise. The other two things are both, in my mind, kind of reserve fund transfer request related. We had a fire, not this Friday, but the Friday before over here on I think Pleasant Lake Ave, and we had to have the house demolished because it presented a imminent hazard. So the initial demolition cost was $1,000. And then we did ask and put out to the bid law encourages you to do an informal process if a formal process would not be in the best interest. So we did obtain three quotes which based upon the amount of money these requests came in at was appropriate process too. And we did have the vendor that had the machine there that had demoed the building did give us a quote that was less than two other bidders. So we had the building taken away because it did present a hazard. I think Chief had mentioned that at last week's meeting. It looks like the total cost is $14,600. So we didn't plan on that. We didn't know that was coming. So I think that that's an appropriate request to submit to the Finance Committee. So I wanted to at least alert the board. The other two bidders that came in, I don't have that material with me. I think both of them were over $20,000. So it was a pretty fair price too for the removal costs. And then the last item that I had, and this one I'd at least like to, the chairman had asked at one of the meetings to come up and see what we could do on the columns on the library. And I did meet with Bob Caffarelli, the town engineer, on Friday, and he received some quotes. And boy, I was shocked. It's about $8,500, and the wood, solid wood or pieced wood, is actually cheaper than the plastic. So what I was thinking about doing is we'll send a request over to the library trustees, and at least I think if the board's comfortable with this, I know that I think at the meeting which the whole building project was talked about, I think the estimate was about $70,000 to redo those. To me, it makes some sense if the library trustees are okay with the wood, which that's what I thought they said they wanted was the wood, then we could put in a request for a reserve fund transfer and get that work done. You know, in my mind, this one does classify as a, you know, potential hazard. We did go up and we have some shoring up there to make sure, but that really is just a temporary stopgap, and I think it does make sense to go forward. So I appreciate the chair kind of pushing and saying, why don't we look at that and see if there's a better alternative. One of the things on the cost, that is just the cost for the columns, so we would have to do the installation. But I've been assured by Mr. Libby that that's something we can do.
It also tells me, regardless of which way you go on the columns, that the estimates from their consultant are just out of line, in my opinion. Now, what was the, you said the FRP was 8,500 or the wood columns?
The wood was 8,500. I think the plastic FRP was, I think, 92.
I think somebody ought to look at the life cycle cost of that whole thing about, you know, painting it and whatnot, how long these things will last, blah, 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 blah. So it's not that big a difference, quite frankly.
What I can do, that's a good point, Mr. Chairman, a very good point. I'll send the material over and I'll CC the board and I'll attach those quotes. Okay.
And I do agree, it's basically a safety thing. I mean, we've got a well-traveled, you know, library, front of the library that now we have supported with 6x6s or whatever it is. I mean, that should get fixed.
And that actually, is the board okay if I'll put together the material and send it to the library trustees with a CC, and then the board can look at it and whichever way you want to go, but I was surprised that the cost was so reasonable. But that concludes my comments this evening.
Okay.
Quick question. The demolition, is there any way that we can charge the owner of the building back?
Yes, because thank you. What we did do simultaneously, my last town, I did a fair amount of demolition work. And every time we did demolition work, we put a demolition lien on. So here, actually, our new building commissioner, I think this was the first time for him. So he did the order. He did a nice job. He's very, very meticulous about following the law. So he looked at the law. You have to do a demolition order. You have a board of survey, goes out, looks at the site, says, yes, this is something that needs to be demolished. And then we did simultaneously the demolition lien. He had done his homework. So the property value of that lot, just obviously the lot now, is I think $63,000. So the property owner has some back taxes plus this, so he has an obligation to the town, including the demolition, of about $25,000. So there are sufficient funds for us to recover, so that would be at least the owner. And he did sign off and gave us consent to go on and do the work. So it's been a amicable, obviously it's a difficult situation, but it's been an amicable situation.
When it sells, we'll get whole again.
So yes, we should be whole when the property sells.
Okay, thank you.
I have a
One second.
I'm set. Thank you.
Okay. Go ahead, Jim. Sorry.
So the number of the 14.6 for the demolition, did the town then have to pay for the removal of the debris on top of that? Did that cost the town or?
Yeah, no. $1,000 was for literally to just knock the building down so we can get the fire to spray the water into where it needed to be. And then the 13.6 was to ship it off, truck it off.
So it did not come to our C&D. It went off somewhere else, and we didn't pay any additional C&D costs.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, no, it would be the contractor obviously paid the C&D charge.
Great.
That house, because it had a lot of material in it, it was not your typical structure. I mean, he had a lot of material in there.
Right.
So it wasn't a typical demolition.
The good news is you can replace the columns at Brooks Library for less than what it costs for take a building off site. All set. Okay.
Thank you, Mr.
You're
Chairman.
All set. Michael?
Thank you.
All set. Janelle, you have anything else?
I'm all set. Thanks.
Okay. I am too. I remind everybody that next Monday is Columbus Day, so we will meet on Tuesday. Unless I get to the agenda material on Wednesday and find out there isn't anything to deal with. So I don't know what we have time sensitive. Maybe that the Allen's Harbor bulkhead maybe has to be dealt with.
Yeah, the Sugar Hill will be something that we need to get to.
Treasure chest.
There you go. Okay. Yeah, you ready for that next week? Good. Great.
Yes, we had a nice meeting with the Treasure Chest people Friday afternoon.
Good.
Just a question for Chris. I haven't received the Excel backup package on the five-year plan yet.
Yes. After the meeting, the next day, the accountant came to me and said that there was a mistake in one of the spreadsheets. So there is a material change. And I was going to work through it today so I could say that you could have it obviously available, and he was out sick today. I think he had a family member that was ill, so he didn't come in. As soon as I can get that he knows that that's a priority, we want to get that to you. But we went from, and I won't hide things, I think I had reported that it was about a $13,000, we were within $13,000 of having the budget. And I think it's now 180. So I want to, yeah, it's a shortfall. So yeah, it's bad news. So I want to get a better sense for why that happened and what happened to that. So that way when I get it to you, because that's going to be your first question, what happened, which would be my first question.
And I'm going to hope I get an answer. So hopefully we'll see that next week, because that's a pretty big swing in my pocketbook.
Is a big swing.
And I don't like not having good answers for the board to questions like that.
Okay.
That's it.
All right. Anybody else?
That's it.
Return. Well, it's early, huh? Excellent. Thank you.